Advent Pharma welcomes you to the ocean of practical knowledge about small animal practice, that is Hadwell's YouTube channel. We are thankful to Dr. Vinod Kumar for sharing his practical tips with fellow veterinarians.
Fever, hyperthermia and hypothermia. We all know a lot of things regarding fever, hyperthermia and hypothermia, because in our clinical practice we are encountering fever daily, encountering it daily, because each and every infectious disease at first can produce multiplication in the blood before their localization. It produces the subsequent multiplication in the blood, produces the subsequent fever. If it is a bacteria, we call it as a bacteremia. If it's a viremia, if it's a virus, we call it as a viremia. Then a protozoal infections. Viremia and bacteremia are the common technical terms used, and protozoa has no specific technical term which can be used. And various other conditions are there which produces increase in temperature. That is what we are going to discuss today. The main topic is fever. Hyperthermia means increase in temperature, body temperature, which is due to a reason other than a pathological reason or a biological factor. That is hyperthermia. Hypothermia means, as you also know, it is decrease in body temperature. So, let us have something to say regarding fever. We all know these technical terms: fever, febrile, pyrexia. Pyrexia is another technical term for fever. Fever is an English term. Fever is an English word. The real technical term is febrile. As when you go to English, it is a feverish man. When we speak, it is a febrile man. We know it. It's a febrile man or a febrile animal. Febra is a Latin technical term, a Latin word, which has the English translation fever. Pyrexia is a Greek term. It is a Greek term where they use pyr, P-Y-R-E, pyr. Pyr means fire in Greek. Fire. So they compare fire and fever because of that temperature, increase in temperature, fire-like temperature. Sometimes our mother will come and touch the forehead. Oh, it is hot like fire. So that is it. We always compare it with fire, temperature of fire. But literally, you know, the temperature of fire is very high. Maybe some 300, 400, 600 degrees centigrade. And our high rise in temperature is something about 39, 40 degrees centigrade. And so, generally, when the temperature is taken, it is better to use, this is my opinion, my personal opinion, it is better to use the temperature unit as Fahrenheit. Because Fahrenheit is more sensitive. The slightest variation also can be determined. That is why it is said the human temperature is 98.6 degree Fahrenheit. 98.9, 99, 100.2, 100.4, etc. can be easily distinguished. But this range is narrow when it is converted into degree Celsius or centigrade. Celsius and centigrade are the same. So, see, in the human clinic, we are attending cases daily. In the human clinic, it is very easy for them to take the temperature, except in pediatry. In pediatry, the small children, they won't allow the nurse or the doctor to come near them. They will abuse them. They will cry loudly. They will kick. They may bite. They may scratch. But in neonatals, it is a little bit easier. But in adult human being, of course, it will be, things will be smooth. Except in very old geriatric patients, they are very violent sometimes. They abuse anything to the nurses, the doctors, etc. So, these type of things are not there in veterinary practice, but we all know what happens when we go and take the temperature. We cannot put the thermometer into the mouth of the animal. Number one is, if it is a dog, it is impossible. Imagine putting the mercurial thermometer into a 2-year Rottweiler male. It is impossible. Another thing, we have to retain it there. Again, it is dangerous because the bulb contains mercury inside. We know what mercury, the heavy metal, is. It's highly poisonous. It will bite and it will chew and it will drink the mercury. It will produce mercury poisoning. It's impossible. And nowadays, we have, of course, we have digital thermometers. It is highly sensitive than the mercurial thermometers. We can put the thermometer not into the mouth of the animal. Of course, you can do it into the mouth of the animal, but it should be a neonatal. But even for neonatals, we are not putting the thermometer into the mouth of the neonatal. So the safest is the rectal temperature. Either you can use the thermometer bulb into the rectum, or if it is a female, into the vagina. Both gives accurate results. The mercurial thermometer or the digital thermometer. If it is a mercurial thermometer, it is better. You insert into it along with the finger so that the finger should guide the thermometer. You should not touch the bulb of the thermometer while you are inserting. Above the bulb, you should touch. Then you should insert the finger along with the thermometer. Slightly tilt it so that the mercurial bulb will touch the mucosa. Keep it there for 1 minute. Before that, you will have to set the thermometer by shaking it. It has to be, the level has to be brought down. But all these things need not to be done in a digital thermometer. You just take it, put it on, then keep it inside, whatever be the mucosa. What you are choosing, a oral mucosa, or you may be choosing the vaginal mucosa, or even you can keep on the groin region in between the belly and the thigh, or you can keep it in the axilla for 1 minute. But while you're keeping in the axilla or on the surface skin, to the temperature which is got, we will have to add 1 degree in excess. Like that, it should be red. Then generally we know it is not like the human patient. When our patient is presented to the clinic, normally he will become so suspicious. The dog or the cat is being presented to a new environment. He is very suspicious. He will become more excited. He will be very suspicious and he will be looking around and he will be very, anxious about what is happening inside. New environment, new people, other animals, all these makes him more excited. So what will happen? Excitement increases the temperature. We can say the normal temperature of other animals, like the lowest temperature. We know among our domestic animals, we have the elephant. Elephant, in your place, it may not be a domestic animal, but in our place, in Kerala state, it is a domestic animal. Because there are a lot of houses where there are elephants. In our earlier ancient culture, in big houses, in very huge houses, it was a custom of keeping male tuskers in their house. Like what we keep a pet dog in a house. Like we keep a chihuahua in our house. They keep male tuskers. And big houses, what they were boasting. I am a person who is owning the house, my house with 3 tuskers, you know. So that was the culture, ancient culture in Kerala. Even nowadays, in Kerala, we can see such houses which hold tuskers or sometimes even females, cow elephants. So, that is why I said elephant is considered to be a domestic animal in Kerala. And now we know the temperature of elephants, it is 97 degree Fahrenheit. As we say, it is normal in the elephant. And the human temperature we know. In humans, except for the neonatals, they don't take an erectile temperature. The normal temperature is 98.6 degree Fahrenheit. In the cow, it is 101.6 degree Fahrenheit. In the horse, it is 100.6 degree Fahrenheit. In the dog, is 101.3 degree Fahrenheit. In the cat is the same. So as in the birds, they are living beings for flying. They need more energy. They need more metabolic energy. So the metabolic rate is more faster than the mammal. So the heat produced is also more in birds. So they have a high temperature, 107 degree Fahrenheit. We know all these things. So while taking the temperature, it is being commonly mistaken as a fever. When we take the temperature, the dog will be excited. See, first of all, our clinical examination details, what they tell? Inspection, palpation, percussion, auscultation, succussion, mensuration. Inspection means before touching the animal, you are a doctor, you are going to examine the patient. Before that, you are judging the animal from a distance. From that time itself, the dog or the cat will be highly suspicious. They will be highly anxious, excited. And now, after a round inspection, you are going to approach and touch the animal. The animal is getting more excited and nervous because you are a stranger. According to him, you are an enemy. You are going to him. You are going to touch. What will happen? Excitement. What induces? During excitement and due to fear and anxiety, catecholamines will be released. Flight to fight hormones. Catecholamines such as adrenaline will be released. Immediately, what is the effect of adrenaline? Immediately, blood supply, there'll be a vasoconstriction. BP increases. Immediately, the blood glucose level increases. So, the metabolic rate itself will increase in 2 or 3 minutes. So metabolic heat will be produced. Quite naturally, in such animals, there will be an increase in temperature. If you take the temperature, now you know that the temperature, normal temperature of your patient, the dog, is 101.3 degree Fahrenheit. Now when you take the temperature, you see it is 102.2 degree Fahrenheit. Immediately, if you are inexperienced, what will you tell? Oh, this dog is having fever. Will you mind it? No, it is not a fever. We should exclude. We should exclude such things. That is why I always teach my children, like my internship trainees and my juniors, always taking the temperature and showing a difference in just 1 degree or 1.5 degrees, not significant. See, take it judiciously or read it and judge it judiciously. That is what the system expects from us. That needs experience also. Also, in the cat, they are much more excited and they are stressed when they are presented to a new environment. And during this stress, if you are taking the rectal temperature, definitely it will be more. So, we are speaking about fever. So before taking the temperature, I always advise, it is my practical experience. You go and touch and you rub the body. Touch, don't pat it. Simply you move your firm palms above the body, the head region, the base of the ears, then the neck, the chest. Everywhere you can feel the temperature, but everywhere it will not be even. There may be some more temperature over the ears, base of the ears, the soft tissues of the ears will be more hot when compared to the dorsal withers. But on the chest areas, if you feel, it may be normal temperature. And you go down, go posteriorly, and you touch the ventral belly, it will be hot. So this thing, when you see, again, you keep your hands palm down the ventral belly onto the inguinal area. It will be extremely hot, as we say, it is very hot in normal animals, especially in puppies. Can you say it is febrile? No, it is normal. So, accurately, if you say it is fever, this fever should be reflected in the rectal temperature. Unfortunately, we cannot put the thermometer into the mouth of the animal. It has to be inserted into the rectum of the animal. Then take it. Nowadays, we have other thermometers. Laser thermometer we have. Laser thermometer can be used from a safe distance. See, if it is a wild animal like a tiger or a leopard, how will you take the temperature? You cannot even think of going near it and inserting the thermometer into the rectum of the tiger. Tiger is such a creature. So, you cannot think of it. So, go near the cage. You can use a laser thermometer. From 1 or 2 meters, you can point it to the laser gun can be pointed to the forehead of the tiger, and then the temperature can be recorded. That is the only measure we can take it. Can you sedate the patient and then take the temperature? Sedation itself will bring down the temperature. You cannot take it. Then nowadays, we have little bit more things like the infrared thermometer, what the people nowadays, health authorities are using to test the COVID. For the COVID patients, first they are using the infrared thermal scanners. The same thing I am using in my hospital. Infrared thermal scanner. And we have to put it on the ears. The best place is the ear. Open the ears well and then place it just 1 inch distance. And then take the temperature. That will be almost accurate. Go on to both the ears, because Sometimes, if the ear is having infection, there is otitis C. Whenever there is inflammation, we have the cardinal signs like rubor, calor, tumor, dolor, fasciolacea. So calor is pain. So calor is increased temperature. When there is otitis externa, if you are using only one ear, very high temperature can be recorded with the infrared thermometer. So use both the ears. So another thing arises. If both the ear is having bilateral otitis, what will you do? Then you may feel that it is high rise in temperature. But when you rubbed the palm over the body, you didn't get any such rise in temperature. So you go for the rectal temperature in such cases. These are all practical tips while taking the temperature. Another thing, a dog is presented with the tenesmus. It is training to pass the stools. That is dysesthesia, difficulty in passing stools through the anus. Dysesthesia. So the dog is presented with the dysesthesia. And now when you record the temperatures, you rub your hands over the body, you don't feel any much temperature. The ears are, the base of the ears are having normal temperature. It is a German Shepherd. Okay, suppose it is a German Shepherd. Now when you take the temperature, it is 104.6 degree Fahrenheit. On the base of the ears, you didn't feel any temperature. Over the ventral belly, you didn't feel any temperature, high temperature. Over any other part such as the brisket or the neck, you didn't feel any high rise in temperature. But over the rectal temperature, while you were recording the rectal temperature, you got this high rise in temperature. What can you assume? The clinical sign is there. The dog is having dysesthesia. It is a 6-year-old male German Shepherd. What can you assume? Almost it is 100% it is having anal sacculitis. That is why there is such a rise in temperature when you took this rectal temperature. Okay, but otherwise it is normal. When you get this 104.5 degree Fahrenheit, high rise in temperature, what is this? My God. Go, you are examining the shoulder lymph node. Prescapular, it is normal. You are palpating the submandibular. It is very important. It is normal. Palpating the popliteal lymph node, it is normal. But the temperature is 104.5 degree Fahrenheit. So the thing, what can you assume? It could be nothing but the anal sac infection. Now your brain is working, the anal sac might have inflamed. Now you can go, you put on a glove, insert it into the finger. I have written in my book how to examine. See, textbooks also it is written. How to examine the right anal sac? How to examine the left anal sac? See, you are standing on the back. While examining the right anal sac, you should use the left finger, left forefinger. They insert it and then you can feel it. You can palpate it. A big nodular mass, painful nodular mass will be there in highly inflamed and painful. And if you want to check the left anal sac, use the right hand. With the gloved right finger, you insert your finger into the anus and then with the thumb and the index finger, you palpate the left anal gland. So that is how we palpate. So thereby, it is almost clearly concluded it is anal sacculitis. Now you can go for the CBC. Probably you may be able to detect the neutrophilia and leukocytosis. Then the treatment according locally, let it be left. So these are certain clues, important basic clues, which we should take into account while we are recording the temperature. If it's a neonatal pup, you can use either the rectal temperature or the oral temperature. But because in neonatals, recording the temperature is very important. In some particular crisis like puppy feeding syndrome. One of the causes is severe hypothermia. It's highly fatal. We have to record the temperature. When you touch the pup, it will be very cold. The extremities will be ice cold. Take the temperature, it will be 96 degree Fahrenheit. What you should do? Immediately take the pup and you should put the pup on a towel. Heat should be given. What I am doing is, in my incubator, I just keep 1 foot high, 140 watt bulb. I have calculated that that would be sufficient to give accurate heat for the pup. 1 foot height, 140 watt bulb. But it should be laid on clean, dry turkey towel. So, my dear friends, fever means it is rise in body temperature. But we have to say that this rise in body temperature is due to pathological factors. If it is not due to some pathological factors, it could be hyperthermia. That I am coming. Hyperthermia is another subject. We are coming again. And fever is mostly reversible. We know fever is reversible. We have lot of means to reduce the fever. In human beings, our fever is being controlled by medical means or managemental means. Why? Because high rising temperature generally affects the head. We have headache, etc. And high rising temperature may adversely affect the meninges and the brain. And so we used to control our high rising temperature by keeping a wet cloth on the forehead as well as the ventral belly, the belly as well as the palm and the foot. The solar surface of the foot as well as the palmar surface of the palm.
Hadvet Pharma launches its Hadpod range. Hadpod, Cefpodoxime 100 mg 200 mg dispersible tablets. Cefpodoxime 100 mg per 5 ml oral suspension. The safe and effective choice for stubborn infections. Cefpodoxime Proxetil dispersible tablets. Hadpod 100 dt and Hadpod 200 dt tablets. Cefpodoxime oral suspension. Hadpod 100 DS, Cefpodoxime Proxetil 100 mg per 5 ml. Indications: Cefpodoxime is used in both dogs and cats to treat a variety of bacterial infections, including skin infections, wound infections, bone infections, pneumonia, and bladder infections. Dosage for dogs: 5 to 10 mg per kg. Once daily for 5 to 7 days. For cats, 5 mg per kg once every 12 hours or 10 mg per kg once daily. Route oral. Presentation 1 into 10 tablets. For syrup 30 ml. You can book your order online at www.hatwit.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
So, but there are other technical methods to control pyrexia, that is fever. Like we have our antipyretic agents. We know very well about antipyretic agents. But do we do any antipyretic therapy? No, we don't do any antipyretic therapy because antipyretic therapy is not commonly employed in veterinary therapy. So, we can use it, but it is not so recommended in veterinary medicine. antibiotics, we have the most widely used antibiotic is the paracetamol. We know the acetaminophen. The paracetamol is a phenol derivative. We know the toxicities of this very dangerous medicine. So, we should be very much aware that at the most, you should not use any antibiotic agent. Don't use it. That is what I used to teach my students. Don't use any antibiotic agent except when indicated. If it is a pyrexia of unknown origin, okay, it is coming. So, most of the fever is reversible. High rise in temperature, whatever it be, can be a hyperthermia or a fever. High rise in this type of temperature can injure or damage the vital organs and vital tissues, especially the kidneys and the brain. Such a high rise in temperature can be generally seen in hyperthermias, and there almost irreversibly renal and cerebral damages take place. We know what we are coming to explain also. Then why there is a fever? Why the God has given this fever? The fever is a beneficiary process. As we all know, it is a beneficial process by which the body increases the metabolism, liberates a lot of heat, and then trying to kill the organisms which has entered. May not be possible sometimes. Or the immune mechanisms has to be stimulated by giving a stimulus. Okay. The temperature of the body is being regulated by a thermoregulatory center in the brain. It is just ventral to the, in the ventral aspect of the cerebrum. Ventral aspect of the cerebrum. It is in the preoptic areas of the anterior hypothalamus. Hypothalamus I have mentioned, like in the class of anorexia. Anterior to the hypothalamus, we have to see, just keep in mind that there is a thermoregulatory center above the hypothalamus, that is all. The normal body temperature, there is always, when we talk about temperature, there will be a range of temperature, body temperature, like 101 to 102.5 degree Fahrenheit. For each and every animal, there is a set point, because there is a thermostat. There is a thermostat, there is a thermostatic mechanism. It is just similar to the thermostatic mechanism. In the thermostat, we can set the point. Up to this level, it is there. So the thermostat can be set to a temperature. So the thermostat is there. See, in an incubator, we need 40 degrees centigrade. What will we do? Heating elements will be there. And heating element will be connected parallelly to a thermostat. It is a thermostat. What is thermostat? In the thermostat, we have to adjust it to the 40 degrees centigrade. So what will happen? When it reaches 40 degrees centigrade, the circuit will be immediately cut. So what will happen? Circuit is open and this heating coil will be put off. This 40 degrees centigrade will be maintained. And again, when it cooling down, temperature, when it becomes lowered, immediately the thermostat will be put on. The circuit will be closed. And so what happens? Immediately, the heating element again functions. So a temperature of 40 degrees centigrade is always maintained in that area. This thermostat, this is a mechanical thermostat, but our biological thermostat is this thermoregulatory center. So in this thermoregulatory center, the homeostatic mechanism or the body itself has adjusted this biological thermostat, that is the thermoregulatory center, to a set point. And this temperature always will be maintained. Let it in the elephant, this set point is 97 degree Fahrenheit. In the humans, this set point is 98.6 degree Fahrenheit. In the dog, this set point is 101.3 degree Fahrenheit. In the horse, this set point is 100.6 degree Fahrenheit. So this set point will be there. When the temperature goes beyond the set point, the thermostat can cut off by mechanical means, cut off the circuit. But here there is no such, maintained circuit like that. But immediately the thermoregulatory center will come to know that it has gone above the set point. Now the remedial measures will be taken by the brain and the thermoregulatory center to bring down the thermometer temperature that we are going to discuss. So that is a set point. There is a set point in this center which will not alter. We cannot alter this set point. We cannot touch it. Only the God or the nature has given this. For each species, it has been given like that. For avians, set point is high. As we say, it is high. For the avians, it is normal. Okay. Any change below or above is sensed due to the set point and remedial measures are taken. Okay. Then, now we have seen fever. Fever has specific signs. Fever itself is a symptom. Fever itself is a sign. But when people, the ordinary people, they say, what do you have? Fever, 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 fever. They all think that fever is a disease. But we are technicians, we are technologists. We know, being a doctor, we know that fever is not a disease. Fever is only a clinical sign. But this clinical sign has certain signs. That is the science of fever. Suppose jaundice has certain clinical signs. What is the clinical sign? Yellowish discoloration of the conjunctiva, yellowish discoloration of the vulva, yellowish discoloration of the ventral belly skin, yellowish discoloration of the inner ear skin, mild to moderate yellow color of the urine, deep yellow color of the feces, yellow color of the mouth. So all these are signs of jaundice. What are signs of ascites? Distension of the abdomen, fluid thrill on ballotment. These are the signs of ascites. Like that, we have the signs of fever. Okay. What are signs of fever? Those are well evident and prominent. There will be shivering. Shivering is seen during the first stage. Then there will be increased pulse and respiratory rates. Why there is increased respiratory rate? The body is increasing the respiratory rate to expire as much of hot air from the body. To expire or to keep away the temperature from the body. Animal will immediately urinate and it will pass the stools. Why? Through the stools and the urine passed, it will be passing or it will be excreting all the heat of the body. There will be irregular external temperature. When you take the external temperature, on different parts it will be irregular. On the head sometimes it will be more. The chest and the upper chest it will be not that hot. On the ventral belly, it will be very hot. On the medial thigh region, it will be very hot. So shivering or rigors, increased pulse and respiratory rate, irregular external temperature, firm feces. It will be firm, then concentrated urine. Yes, these are all we know very well. So, the fever has certain stages. We have certain stages of fever. That we have all studied in our first or second year itself. The stage of increment, the stage of vestigium, and the stage of decrement. The stage of increment or the stage of onset, there the fever starts. The internal temperature is rising, but the external temperature we cannot find it out. The skin will be static. There on the skin, we may not be able to feel any hot, any heat. So the internal temperature is rising and the skin capillaries are constricted, with the result that the animal feels cold and shivers. That is the first stage. Shivering is the first stage. That is the stage of increment or stage of onset. Internal temperature increases, there will be peripheral vasoconstriction, slight peripheral capillary constriction. Along with that, we can see that the animal will feel the cold and shivers. That is known as rigors. This type of shivering is known as rigors. And then we know the second stage, that is the stage of vestigium. See, by the increment, it will be going to the peak, the temperature will be going to the peak, and by the stage of vestigium, it will be reaching the peak. Stage of period of maximum temperature, during which the body temperature remains more or less constant and shivering also stops. Shivering stops. Then, third stage, by the third stage, antipyresis occurs due to certain mechanisms we are going to study in the body, and the temperature will come down and there will be a release of body heat. During this time, the temperature falls in the body and goes to cold conditions. And this is known as, and see, the main condition or the main mechanism in the human being is sweating. By sweat, all the body heat will be liberated and the body will become ice cool. And so this stage is known as a stage of decrement or defervescence. But in the dogs, stage of defervescence is not so prominent. Why? Because there are no sweat glands on the body. Sweat glands are there, but extremely low. Now we remember the dermatology class. So stage of increment or onset, stage of vestigium, and stage of decrement or stage of defervescence. When there is a rapid reduction in temperature, when there is a rapid reduction in the normal, in the fever, when there is a rapid reduction in the fever and the temperature is returning to the normal abruptly, that is within a few hours or minutes, it is known as a crisis. And slowing down of the temperature is known as lysis. Just remember all these technical terms. Crisis and lysis. Abrupt decrease or ekdam decrease is known as crisis. And slow and incremental decrease is known as lysis. Whatever it be, whether it is a fast recovery or a slow recovery, in both these cases, whenever you are taking the temperature, you should feel the pulse also. That is an international law. Why? According to all textbooks and according to my experience also, when you are taking the temperature, see, if you are subjected with a dog with high rising temperature, You see that the temperature of that dog is too high, it is 105 degree Fahrenheit. Okay, it is having fever, you know very well, it is febrile. And at the same time, you see that the fever is decreasing because you have given an antipyretic. It is decreasing. Or sometimes you see that it is in the stage of defervescence, it is decreasing. Now, when it is in that temperature, you give the antipyretic. Suppose you are giving an antipyretic because you are afraid of some other pathological factors like brain tissue death, etc. You are now giving an antipyretic and then waiting for the temperature to come down. Give the antipyretic. Let it be meloxicam. You are giving meloxicam and waiting for the temperature to come down. While that time, every 3 minutes, you should record the pulse also. That is what Stalwart says. Every 3 minutes, you have to record the pulse. Because when you want to say that the animal is having an infectious disease, invariably, the animal is having an infectious disease. And if you want to prognose that, it is having a good prognosis. You should feel that the pulse rate is also coming down. If the temperature along with the pulse rate also decreases, then you can say that the disease is having a good prognosis. Otherwise, when the temperature is decreasing, this pulse rate is shooting up, gone. Immediately you should say that. See, that is a very dangerous thing. Always when you are giving an antipyretic or when you are observing during pyrexia, you should feel the pulse every 3 minutes, up to 10 minutes. See, by 10 minutes, this will subside. When you are giving the antipyretic, by 10 minutes, the temperature will subside. But by this time, every 3 minutes, you have to look the pulse rate. Pulse rate, how to look the pulse rate? It is so simple. You need not keep your fingers for 1 minute. Just keep your fingers for 15 seconds. So 15 seconds, suppose it is 20 pulses per 15 seconds. So the pulse, total pulses per minute, that is the pulse rate, 20 into 4, that is 80. That will give you the pulse rate. Need not keep your fingers like this and keep yourself like this for 1 minute. No, you can go and do other works. See, feel the pulse, always feel the pulse with three fingers. Always feel the pulse with three fingers, not as a single finger. Always use the three fingers. The pulse should be taken like this. This is the artery. See, this is the way to take the pulse with the three fingers. And not pressing too much and not releasing too much, but a firm press. And you see, you do like this also. Somehow to a certain extent you can feel how pressure, what is the pressure of the artery inside, pressure of the blood inside. That also you can detect. That needs a little bit of tricky exercise. So feel the pulse. This is the femoral artery. You feel the pulse like this with the three fingers. And you keep it there by feeling it, the pulse for 15 seconds. Take it. 15, the number of beats per 15 seconds into 4 will give you the pulse rate per minute. If the pulse rate is decreasing, along with the decrease in temperature, you should say that dog is okay. We can manage it somehow. Otherwise, if the temperature is decreasing and the pulse rate is increasing, never give a good prognosis. It is always a bad prognosis. Always, invariably. That is an important clue you should keep in your mind while a clinical examination is going on. Don't forget this. Please don't forget this, for heaven's sake, especially my dear juniors. Just by the simply the pulse itself, we can prognose. You are prognosing that it is having a bad prognosis. You cannot save the patient. Okay.
Hadfield Pharma introduces its herbal range, Hadpyrin Syrup. Natural and safe antipyretic, analgesic and anti-inflammatory. With the benefits of Guruchi, Sunthi, Vacha, Yashti Madhu and Musta herbs. Antipyretic, analgesic and anti-inflammatory syrup, Hadpyrin syrup. Indications: fever of multiple etiologies, post-surgical procedures pain management, painful condition like acute sports injuries, osteoarthritis and juvenile arthritis in pets, menstrual cramps in bitches. Dosage: for small breeds, 1 to 2 ml twice a day. For large breeds, 2 to 4 ml twice a day. For cats, 1 ml twice a day. Root: oral. Presentation: 60 ml. You can book your order online at www.hatwit.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
So, peripheral and central thermoreceptors sense the changes in ambient temperature, and this reflex arc is connected to organs which are taking part in dissipation or conservation of body temperature. See, there are all these thermoreceptors, all the body parts are filled with lot of receptors, pain receptors, thermoreceptors, osmotic receptors, pressure receptors, lot of receptors are there. And all those receptors, evenly distributed all over the body, they will give the brain, always see, the brain is sitting there on the throne. The brain has lot of messengers everywhere. Like the brain is a king, he will be sitting there. Who will be passing all the information? The receptors elsewhere, like the thermoreceptors on the skin, they will pass the information that the ambient temperature is too high. Immediately, what that body will do? A brain will sense, oh, okay, I see, okay, thank you, very good. Now I can know that the ambient temperature is so high. So what will the brain do? The brain will immediately send messages to the autonomic nervous system to undertake vasodilatation or vasoconstriction. So vasodilatation occurs, especially peripheral vasodilatation occurs, and what will happen? There will be peripheral vasodilatation and the skin will be having an increased blood supply. There will be flushing over the skin. So that there will increase the peripheral circulation and the heat inside the body will be dissipated outside. So that the body temperature will be dissipated outside. Likewise, the thermoreceptors on the body say that, oh, it is cold, extremes of cold. It is Himachal Pradesh. It is 7 degrees centigrades. And it is November. See, me, myself, I am staying in a place which is temperate in nature. Kerala state has a static temperature always. Not going to extremes of hot climates or nor coming below cold extremes. We have never seen cold extremes below 22 degrees centigrades. Not 22, even 23, 24 degrees centigrades. And also not extremes of heat above 36 degrees centigrades. So Kerala state is having almost a static climate all the time throughout the year. See, all on a sudden, if I am picked up from here and put into Antarctica, I will suffer like anything, because my skin is already accustomed to the temperate or the static temperate climate. And so this is the problem. But there is a thermoregulatory center and these peripheral and central receptors all over the body. When there is a cool climate, immediately the coldness will be felt by the peripheral thermoreceptors and this message will be sent to the brain. What the brain will tell the autonomic nervous system? Hey, cut off all the peripheral circulation. Cut off all the peripheral circulation, not urinate. If you are urinating, means all the temperature will be lost. So, By cutting off all the peripheral circulation, what will happen? The flushing will be gone, the skin will be having less blood supply, and so heat dissipation will be lowered. So that is the by the how conservation or heat is being conserved in the body, conserved in the body by dissipation or conservation of body temperature. It is done by the peripheral and the central thermoreceptors. So when there is a stress or when there is excitement, like what we saw the dog on the table inside our clinic, it is excited, it is anxious, and immediately what happens? Chemical mediators such as catecholamines will be released. All these catecholamines and other chemical mediators, especially adrenaline and 5-hydroxytryptamine, that is serotonin, they will act to raise and reset the set point for producing fever. They will reset, they will work on the thermostat by moving the thermostat point from the normal side to the higher side so that the fever is produced. They are actually producing the fever. Mediators producing the fever. Always true fever should be differentiated from hyperthermia. I will tell how to differentiate hyperthermia. It is so easy. And in hyperthermia, this translocation of the thermostat is not there. In fever, this adrenaline and the serotonin will translocate the set point from here to the upper areas. But in hyperthermia, this set point will not be changed, but the simply the body temperature increases due to other factors in which we are going to study it. Increasing the body temperature is always mediated by sympathetic control and decreases by parasympathetic control. Leave it. We have to study about pyrogens. Pyrogens are those chemical agents which can bring about fever. See, there is a joke regarding pyrogen. One of our friend went to the medical shop. He quarreled with the medical shop wala. Why? The medical shop wala, he said, see, nothing is here. Please go with this. No, you cheated my client. What? See, there is something free with this Ringer's lactate bottle. No, nothing is free there. It is only that Ringer's lactate bottle. No, there is something free. It is written here, pyrogen free. Where is that pyrogen? It is free along with this. Oh, so that was a joke during our old veterinary colleges. So that is pyrogen. A pyrogen means, pyro means it is fire. It is a fever. Pyrogen means any chemical mediator which is producing the fever. So, pyrogens are of two types. Exogenous pyrogens and endogenous pyrogens. Exogenous means exo, you know very well. Coming from outside. The parvovirus is flying and coming and getting into the body of the dog. It produces some chemical mediators inside the body. These are the pyrogens. These pyrogens will set the thermoregulatory center to the upper areas so that fever occurs. Pyrogens coming from outside, such as bacterial endotoxins, viruses, fungi, parasites, protozoa, toxins, tumors, bile acids, drugs such as steroids and tetracyclines, and those released from necrotic tissues. All these. See, a dog was going thereby. A car hit the dog and produced severe injuries. Injuries all over the body. Severe trauma. Lot of injuries. What will happen? On the third day, there will be a febrile reaction. Why on the third day? Why not on that single, the same day itself? See, necrosis happens not on that day. Necrosis happens on the second or the third day especially. During that necrotic phase, necrotic tissues release certain pyrogens. These pyrogens will reach the thermoregulatory center, setting this set point to the top, producing fever. That is why it is always said that after a surgery or a trauma, fever occurs on the third day. Fever occurs on the third day. And these exogenous pyrogens, they can in turn release endogenous pyrogens. Endogenous pyrogens means they are formed inside the body itself. But exogenous pyrogens are responsible for endogenous pyrogen production. That means for endogenous pyrogens to occur, exogenous pyrogens are essential. They will produce fever. And endogenous, from where these endogenous pyrogens come? They are released, they are produced and released by certain areas like neutrophils, eosinophils, monocytes, macrophages in the liver, spleen and alveolus, etc. From all these areas, endogenous pyrogens are secreted. Why? Due to the influence of the exogenous pyrogens. What are these endogenous pyrogens? I also already said that exogenous coming pyrogens are coming from outside. Virus or bacteria is coming from outside. They in turn stimulate and they will produce exogenous pyrogens. And these exogenous pyrogens will secrete or will produce or release endogenous pyrogens from neutrophils, eosinophils, monocytes, liver, spleen, alveolar, macrophages, etc. Okay, what are these endogenous pyrogens? They are nothing but the actual inflammatory mediators. They are actually responsible for the inflammation. They are the inflammatory mediators like interleukins, tumor necrosis factor, interferons, prostaglandin E, etc. Then we know very well the action of prostaglandin E. Out of these four, interleukins, tumor necrosis factor, interferons and prostaglandin E, PGE. PGE is the most important one because PGE is highly responsible for the inflammation to happen. And we know that PGE is being produced by conversion of arachidonic acid. Arachidonic acid is being converted to PGE by the enzyme cyclooxygenase. And this cyclooxygenase enzyme binding and this action is known as a cyclooxygenase pathway. Specific drugs such as anti-inflammatory drugs will bring about inhibition of this cyclooxygenase enzyme. We tell that the cyclooxygenase pathway is blocked and so PGE will not form, for prostaglandin will not form. And what happens? Inflammation reduces. That is the mechanism of action of anti-inflammatory drugs. So these inflammatory mediators, such as, that means the secondary, that is a endogenous pyrogens, or the inflammatory mediators. Inflammatory mediators are responsible for translocating the setting point of the thermoregulatory center to the top areas. Okay, simply as a theoretical portion, I mentioned all these things. Whenever there is a fever, there are certain good and bad effects. Good and bad effects of the fever. Generally, as I said, better you don't suppress a fever. For that, we should say why we should not suppress the fever. At the most, we should not suppress the fever. There are certain people, lot of people are there. Whenever there is a small fever, immediately they will go and start swallowing paracetamol tablet. I should say that these people are very idiotic people. All this paracetamol is a very dangerous drug. All antipyretics are very dangerous. Why they are simply eating and swallowing all these paracetamol tablets with a single fever? The fever occurs, it is having a beneficial effect on the body. Which are the beneficial effects? So suppress, there are certain beneficial effects. In the primary acute phase, interleukin 1 releases haptoglobin. We studied that interleukins, interferons, etc. are the endogenous pyrogens which are released from neutrophils, leukocytes, etc. And these interleukins will come and they will release from inside the cells, somatic cells like haptoglobins, ceruloplasmins, C-reactive proteins and fibrinogen. So they will see, keep in mind, they studied well. The endogenous pyrogens such as the interleukins will come and they will release during the inflammatory process, they will release haptoglobin, ceruloplasmin, C-reactive protein and fibrinogen. And the most important ones are ceruloplasmin and C-reactive protein. And among these two, the most important is the C-reactive protein. And when there is a hike in the C-reactive protein in the blood, we can say that there is a severe inflammation going on. Got it? That is why whenever we are admitted to the doctor's nursing home or the hospital with a high rise in temperature, they will immediately take the C-reactive protein. Whether it is not a simply a fever, whether inflammatory and necrotic reactions are going on. To study that, they will take the level of the C-reactive protein. Sometimes when they go deep into it, they will take the ceruloplasmin level also. But ceruloplasmin is not being estimated everywhere. That is why doctors, they go for C-reactive proteins only. So presence of hike in C-reactive protein is highly indicative of an inflammatory necrotic reaction somewhere in the body. See, we can say that only somewhere in the body, and which organ means we have to find it out. That is in the acute phase. And at the same time, bacteria or virus is coming. They are attacking. This is the reason for fever. So what happens is that this C-reactive protein, the ceruloplasmin, etc., they will lower the plasma ion level. Plasma ion level will be lowered. And so what will happen? See, for the unstagnated multiply or multiplication of the bacteria or some viruses, iron is invariably needed. Without iron, most of the bacteria and some of the viruses cannot multiply. So in the lowered iron level of the blood, what will do? Most of the bacteria will be died. So this ceruloplasmin, C-reactive protein, etc. will bring down the serum, the plasma ion level. So do you think that it is not a beneficiary process? Yes, this happens only because the fever has happened due to the release of secondary or the endogenous pyrogens. So that is why it is said that endogenous pyrogens are highly effective as a beneficiary process. And thereby, another thing also happens. These endogenous pyrogens activates the T cells, T lymphocytes. We all know the T lymphocytes are highly responsible for humoral immunity. T cells are responsible for the humoral immunity. What are the T cells? These are the primary lymphocytes, the thymic lymphocytes. We say the thymic lymphocytes. Some thymic lymphocytes will be released to the blood after activation. We call as the blood lymphocytes or the B lymphocytes. So these endogenous pyrogens will activate the T lymphocytes and boost up the immunity. See, these are the effects. It will lower the blood plasma ion level so that no more multiplication can of the bacteria or viruses can be reduced. And at the same time, these endogenous pyrogens will stimulate the T lymphocyte to produce or to enhance the immunity, the humoral immunity. So now, do you think that you will give an antipyretic in the dog or in the human being? No, better not to give any antipyretic. Also, If things are going beyond control, of course you can do. If things are going beyond control, of course you can do. Otherwise, better don't administer any antipyretic. That is why it is said, so better don't suppress the fever, treat the disease. See, we are not homeopaths. Homeopaths, in homeo medical science, what they are doing is, they are treating the symptoms rather than the cause of the disease. They are not concerned about the cause of disease. They are concerned about the symptoms only. But here we are allopaths. We are concerned about the, we are on the true path. We are concerned about the cause of the disease. Whether it is the bacteria or the fungus or the protozoa, whatever it be, we are concerned about it. So go for the diagnosis. Treat the primary disease. The primary disease for the fever in the dog could be canine distemper, could be acute UTI, could be bronchopneumonia, could be coronaviral enteritis, could be parvoviral enteritis. Okay, we have seen it. But when should be used these antipyretics? When should be used in the dog or the cat? Antibiotics are used in the dog or the cat only in long-standing fever, that is fever for more than 5 days or 6 days. Antibiotics are generally not recommended in animals, that is why. There are certain classification for the fever. We have different types of fevers. Intermittent fever or undulating fever. Sustained fever or persistent fever. Remittent fever or septic fever. What is the intermittent fever? The term itself says the truth. It is intermittent. For some time, it is having high rise. For some time, it becomes normal. Undulating, like this. So such an undulating fever is seen in brucellosis in the bovines. Undulating fever is seen in foot and mouth disease, especially brucellosis. And the biphasic fever is seen in canine distemper. That's also a slight undulating fever, a biphasic fever. First, there will be a hike in the temperature produced during a viremia. By the immune system, it goes down. Then a static time. Again, there is a fever. That is due to the secondary bacterial infection of the pulmonary system. So a biphasic fever occurs in canine distemper. So this is intermittent fever or undulating fever. Then a sustained fever. Sustained fever means the same pattern of fever, the same temperature is going without any change for more than 5 days, more than 6 days, sometimes even for weeks. Sustained fever or a persistent fever. Then a remittent fever. The remittent fever means daily there is a slight increase, then coming down, again increase, coming down, again increase, coming down. That is a remittent fever or a septic fever. There is, in between, there are spikes of fever produced. That is a type of remittent fever or a septic fever. That is uncommon. In dogs, intermittent fever and sustained fever are very common.
Hadvit Pharma introduces its herbal range, Hadpyrin tablets, natural and safe antipyretic and anti-inflammatory, with the benefits of Giloy, Sont, Vach, Mulethi, and Musta. Natural and safe antipyretic and anti-inflammatory tablets, Hadpyrin tablets. Indications: fever of multiple etiologies, post-surgical procedures pain management, painful condition like acute sports injuries, osteoarthritis and juvenile arthritis in pets, menstrual cramps in bitches. Dosage: for small breeds, 1 tablet once a day. For large breeds,
2 tablet once a day. For cats, half to 1 tablet once a day. Root, oral. Presentation, 1 into 10 tablets. You can book your order online at www.hadwit.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
So true fever. See, whenever we are dealing with a high rise in temperature in a dog, we should determine whether it is a true fever or a hyperthermia. For that, we will come to hyperthermia area and then we will describe what hyperthermia is. Hyperthermia is somewhat very, very difficult thing to handle. And it is very dangerous also. Hyperthermia, in general hyperthermia, we see hyperthermia only in one condition in our veterinary practice. That is invariably heat stroke. For the heat stroke to occur, some of our vets may think that it has to go out to the sunshine and stand there, then only they will get the heat stroke. No, that is sunstroke. Heat stroke occurs only due to high ambient temperatures. High ambient environmental temperatures. Especially, heat stroke is very commonly seen in German Shepherds, Pugs, St. Bernards, Weimaraners, etc. Even in Rottweilers it is seen. But you see, our ordinary mongrel dogs, they don't have any hyperthermia. They simply roam around. They are highly resistant. How this occurs? Yes, these German Shepherds or Weimaraners or the St. Bernards, they are brought from outer cold countries. They have a breed predisposition of intolerance to heat because their temperature set is at the lower areas. We know all these things. So heat stroke is the main condition where we get hyperthermia. In some other conditions also we will get hyperthermia, like overexertion. Overexertion of the muscles, they bring about high rise in temperature and heat stroke, hyperthermia occurs. Primary hypothalamic lesions, it is very rare. Drug reactions, that is also rare in our clinics. Grand mal seizures, when there is severe convulsions, let it be a continuous seizure. That is a very difficult thing, grand mal seizure. In grand mal seizures, we have epileptic seizures, grand mal seizures. What is that? Grand mal is very, very dangerous. The convulsions will be continuous. And in continuous grand mal seizures, the body will be shivering and convulsing like anything, and temperature of the body increases. See, when there is convulsion due to the muscle shivering, the muscle contraction, a lot of glycogen will be metabolized, converted to glucose, body heat will be produced, and temperature increases. This temperature is not fever, this is hyperthermia. For example, when we see OP poisoning. In OP poisoning, it is so classical. In all type of poisonings, especially OP poisoning, we have four general clinical signs in OP poisoning. Which are they? Severe convulsions, salivation, that is hyperthialism, salivations, hyperthermia, and meiosis, pinpoint pupil. These are the four pathognomonic signs. All these four occurs, it is nothing but an OP poisoning. I have seen this several times. So in such conditions, it is inevitable that hyperthermia occurs. So also in strychnine poisoning, this Strychnos naxomica is very common all over Kerala state. Dogs are highly sensitive to strychnine. Dogs can consume. See, normally it won't consume it because it is very bitter in taste. It is very bitter. It is a king of bitterness, they say. It is a king of bitter taste. And so somehow they come in contact with the leaf or the root of this Strychnos naxomica. They have eaten it. Or sometimes malicious poisoning by using Strychnos bark and the Strychnos root and leaves. They have high content of strychnine. Malicious poisonings. They consume it. And strychnine poisoning is having some pathognomonic symptom. Like it is a very powerful spinal cord stimulant. So what will happen? The dorsal vertebral muscles will undergo convulsions and excitations. And all this, generally all the skeletal muscles of the limbs and the neck. It will be highly hyper excitable. It will be having an opisthotonic shape. All the four limbs will be stretched. The neck will be stretched. And you tap on the tip, you tap on the table, immediately it will become excited and the convulsion immediately increases. So in this time, if you take the temperature, it will be very high, very high. Something around 105, 106 degree Fahrenheit. You cannot say it is a fever. It's a hyperthermia due to convulsion. Then in hyperthyroidism. In hyperthyroidism, due to the high amount of thyroid hormones, there will be high amount of thyroid hormones when this thyroid hormone will be responsible for high metabolic rate in the somatic cells and due to liberation of metabolic heat. And hyperthyroidic dogs or cats will be having high fever. See, this hyperthermia, it's not fever, high rise in temperature. But hyperthyroidism is not common, not a common feature in dogs. And it is very common in felines, in cats. Whereas hypothyroidism is common in dogs, but not in felines. Then in pheochromocytoma, there also hyperthermia can occur. Yesterday I mentioned about pheochromocytoma. It's a primary tumor of the adrenal cortex. So from the adrenal cortex, catecholamines such as adrenaline will be released. Adrenaline, as it is fight hormone, it increases the peripheral circulation. It produces vasoconstriction. It produces hypertension. It produces hyperglycemia. So there will be increased activity of the somatic cells producing more body heat. That is hyperthermia. Then we have some other fever of unknown origin. See, among our veterans, I should frankly say that it is a common technical term used. Because at least some of our doctors may not be able to diagnose what the condition is. And they tell that, oh, it is fever of unknown origin. Why? They cannot diagnose. But according to technical books, textbooks, how you can say a fever of unknown origin? In a prolonged fever, if there are no specific clinical signs for days together, suppose our hospital is here and 1 kilometer ahead, they got 2 cases of parvoviral enteritis. And one of our dog presented to my clinic is having retching. Immediately I will think of it, oh, the parvo, it was there. Yesterday it was there. So this dog may be also having parvoviral enteritis. So what I will say, no, my dear gentleman, please don't bring the dog inside. It could be parvo. Let us wait for the clinical signs to arise. And we are waiting for the clinical signs. It has only vomited two times. It was only gastritis. I told him to vomit for two, three days. By giving ORS. So such clinical signs may not arise. So in a prolonged fever, if no specific clinical signs are there, we can say that it is a fever of unknown origin, because we are not able to diagnose the origin of the fever. When the fever is for more than 3 weeks, there is anorexia, lethargy and weight loss, definitely. When all these conditions come together, we can say it's a fever of unknown origin. The temperature always will be elevated at least by 1.5 degree Fahrenheit. And we have an uncertain diagnosis. That is FUO, fever of unknown origin. Now we can think about the causes of fever. Causes of fever. Localized and systemic infections. Whatever be the infection, now we are coming to the infections. It makes 40% of the total fever presented to us. 40% is infections. So the majority is infections. Immune mediated disorders are 20%. Neoplasms are 20%. Miscellaneous disorders, we will come to miscellaneous, it is 10%. All the rest of causes which are not coming under these four categories, 10% we say as true fever of unknown origin. So fever of unknown origin, if you are getting 100 fevers, out of the 100 fevers, 10%, that is 10 number of fevers will be fever of unknown origin. Let's say there are four causes for fever. Localized and systemic infections. Let us say the infections. Let us see what are the commonest infections. Number one should be given to bacterial endocarditis. Are we able to diagnose this bacterial endocarditis all the time? So bacterial endocarditis may be a feature when it is produced from different other systemic disorders, infectious disorders. So a bacterial endocarditis, it is mostly very common. And second is protozoal diseases like babesiosis, leishmaniosis, etc. And as I said earlier, leishmania, infantum infection is not so common. When we studied about the vector-borne diseases, we have mentioned that even though we have studied about leishmania, infantum infection, it's not very commonly seen. But babesia, it is very common, extremely common. Tick-borne infections such as babesia is extremely common. And we should say the commonest protozoal infection. That is why we always say whenever the dog is presented with, it is all the stalwarts say, when the dog is presented with fever, when the canine patient is febrile, immediately you start with tetracycline and berenil. Earlier also, old stalwarts were saying, when your patient is presented with fever, always start with tetracycline and berenil because of suspicion of this vector-borne infection. Stalwarts always say that vector-borne infection is the commonest than bacterial endocarditis. Because even bacterial endocarditis can occur as sequel to babesia infection. Then other infections such as Lyme disease. We mentioned about Lyme disease. Lyme disease, my first case of Lyme disease, suspected Lyme disease was, I think what it was during 2009. A Labrador was presented, three and a half years Labrador was presented to my clinic with lameness. The Honor clearly told that antibiotics were injected by one another, the doctor, where this animal was having lameness on the left forelimb on the first day. And after 3 days of injection, the left forelimb pain was gone and it started in pain on the right forelimb. Then it was changed to the right hind limb, again to the left forelimb. So the lameness was shifted from leg to leg. So we can say a shifting lameness. See, go to our previous classes in vector-borne disease. A shifting lameness. Suppose a shifting lameness is seen in a cow. What can be assumed? A shifting lameness is nothing but a 3-day fever or ephemeral fever in the cow. Invariably, most of our doctors who are sitting here are mostly mixed animal practitioners. They all know very well, and especially during the start of the rainy season, we have a lot of tabanus and stomoxes. Stomoxes calcitrans and tabanus striatus are very commonly found flies, and they transmit ephemeral fever virus, and we have a 3-day fever virus. So it shows a shifting lameness. But if there is a shifting lameness in a dog, the primary thing you have to suspect is Lyme disease. And you know the Lyme disease is being produced by Borrelia burgdorferi, the spirochete. Then infections such as leptospirosis. Of course, leptospirosis is very commonly found in our clinical practice. Leptospirosis, earlier we had leptospirosis where the commonest etiological factors were Leptospira icterohemorrhagiae, Canicola, Pomona, and Gripotyphosa. Nowadays, we don't have all these things. Icterohemorrhagiae and Canicola are still there, but newer studies say that it has been mutated. And nowadays, in Kerala state, we have isolated certain strains like Leptospira australis and Leptospira autumnalis. I think in Tamil Nadu state also, this is very prevalent. That is why our vaccines, what is given, what being given, they are not active against, or they don't give any immunity against leptospirosis. This is one reason, because these are highly antigen specific. Antigenic variation is important. Antigen to antigen. So I think our conservative vaccines has icterohemorrhagia and Canicola. That is why Leptospira were previously known as Canicola fever. So leptospirosis can be a cause of fever. Then rickettsial organisms such as Ehrlichia, Haemomontanella. See, in Ehrlichia, we know very well, the multiplication process is so long standing. The infective stage from the RBCs or from the somatic cells, so from the primary multiplication, it enters the monocytes and it transforms into the morula, which will be retained for a very long time. And this morula stage is highly infective and there produces fever. Especially a long-standing fever which is undulating in nature, slightly undulating, or unstable fever. So Ehrlichia, we know the diagnosis of Ehrlichia because we have discussed everything in the VBD class. Then Haemobartonella, like our old epirethrozole. Haemobartonella, the diagnosis of, you see, now coming to the diagnosis of Ehrlichia, we know how to diagnose it. The morula can be detected in the monocytes. Or in Haemobartonella, the organisms are found as coccoid organisms, which are seems to be extra fittings over the periphery of the RBCs. Then systemic mycosis can produce fever, such as histoplasmosis, blastomycosis and cryptococcidiosis. Blastomycosis and histoplasmosis are not very common in our country, but even this can happen. Produces severe pulmonary infections and also systemic infections. They are known as systemic mycosis. Cryptococcus neoformans, they produces severe ulcerative infections on the face of cats. We know if the cat is presented with the severe oral ulcerated lesions, we can say it could be a mural ulcer, murine ulcer, or cryptococcosis. So it produces fever. Then psittacosis. We have chlamydia citrosi, biovar, lymphogranuloma tracheitis. We have chlamydia citrosi, biovar, lymphogranuloma venereum. And this psittacosis is not so common. Pyothorax or inhaled foreign bodies, etc., can produce fever. Hepatic abscesses, a long standing fever which you cannot diagnose. I met with the case of a Labrador which was having protracting vomiting, unstable protracting vomiting for days together, and it was not responding to any antibiotic. I thought it was gastritis first. I undertook all the second gastritis like IV fluids, antibiotics. During that time I had pantoprazole. I gave everything, but there was no response. Then it is written in my textbook also, this was long back. Upon palpation of the intestine, there was hepatomegaly. So I tried to aspirate something from the liver. When I aspirated, it was pus. It was a clear occurrence of multiple hepatic abscess. That was the cause of that fever and gastritis, vomiting. There was a long standing fever in that case. So why this happens? Why this was not responding to any antibiotic? Because it will not respond, because it is an abscess. There is no blood circulation to the abscess. How can it respond? The only treatment is aspiration of the pus. Aspirate the, you go through the stalwarts books, they say aspirate the pus. Nowadays we have ultrasound guided aspiration, etc. Osteomyelitis, definitely they produce due to the maybe injudiciary application of bores during a intraosseous fluid therapy. First of all, you should sterilize well before undertaking a fluid therapy into the bone marrow. So also during an orthopedic surgery, so many doctors are sitting here doing orthopedic surgery excellently, very well. They all know to maintain the asepsis very well. They're doing all beautiful surgeries.
Hatwood Pharma introduces Heparaj Plus Tablets. L-Ornithine, L-Aspartate 250 mg, Thiamine Mononitrate 1.5 mg, Riboflavin 1.5 mg, Pyridoxine Hydrochloride 1.5 mg, Nicotinamide 20 mg, Calcium, D-Pantothenate 5 mg, Silymarine 100 mg and Folic Acid 1 mg. Multivitamin supplement with the power of Silymarine. Heparaj Plus Tablets. Hepatoprotectant systemic drug. Indications: supplement to support healthy growth, general weakness and debility, geriatric support, chronic and acute liver disease, cirrhosis. Hepatoprotective agent when hepatotoxic agents are ingested. Example, death cap mushrooms. Beneficial in preventing certain cancers and improving the efficacy and reducing the negative effects of chemotherapy for certain tumors. Dosage, for small breeds, 1 tablet per day. Medium and large breeds, 1 tablet twice a day. Route, oral. Presentation 1:10 tablets. You can book your order online at www.hadfit.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
If there is a slight difference also, it can produce osteomyelitis, because in orthopedic surgery, we are putting the plates, we are screwing it, we are drilling the bones, we are handling broken bones. So all chances of osteomyelitis is there. Then stump pyometra. Stump pyometra is not so uncommon. All the animal will be vomiting and having polydipsia. But what is this? Animal vomiting and polydipsia, but the animal's uterus had been taken out years before. Oophorohysterectomy had been done. Now what's it? Still it is having this polydipsia. Now you are undertaking an ultrasound examination. You can see the stump. That is right. Because ultrasound is the best method by which you can diagnose stump pyometra. And pyelonephritis, prostatic abscesses, all these can produce fever. Pyelonephritis, see, the day before yesterday, a case came to my clinic. Now, even now, today also, we gave the antibiotics, drips and everything. This is a Rottweiler. This Rottweiler is highly affectionate to the client. Even this morning, the client rang up to me and cried like anything, because it is highly affectionate. The creatinine level is 10.6. That is yesterday evening report. Creatinine is 10.6. The blood urine nitrogen is 426. How can I save the dog? See, what happened was, it had a chronic cystitis. Some treatments were going on. I think some other treatments were going on, like that, and some antibiotics, gentamicin or something were given. I don't know. And it had a ureteritis. Ascending infection took ureteritis and then pyelonephritis. Pyelonephritis, pyemic nephritis, and then total bilateral nephritis. Now both the kidneys are gone. On ultrasound, it is completely fibrotic, fibrosed. The client is telling, somehow, doctor, at any cost, we are ready to spend any amount of money, please save it. How can I do it? So that is pyelonephritis, prostatic abscesses. One of my friends said, a very interesting case. A dog was having long-standing constant fever. And also, it was training to pass the stools. A middle-aged toy breed. I remember it was a Shih Tzu. Operated it. And found that at the lower region of the pelvic area, there was a very large mass, but a fluctuating mass. During that time, they could not know what it was. They punctured it. See, actually, it should not be done. They punctured it, and pus was flowing like anything. That was a prostatic abscess. Then after that, they cleaned everything. The dog became okay. That was a prostatic abscess. During that time, we had no ultrasound. If we had an ultrasound, means definitely we would have diagnosed it. See, when he did the prostatic, this is finger exploration through the rectum, he found a globular mass. That is why they did the exploratory laparotomy. So that is another case anyway. In felines, FELV and FIV, feline leukemia virus and feline immunodeficiency virus, they all produce fever. Malignant neoplasms, yes. Why neoplasms produce fever? Yesterday, I mentioned in our weight loss and weight gain class, neoplastic cells, they consume lot of energy. They need lot of energy because they are fast multiplying cells and their metabolic rate is very high. And when there is a systemic neoplastic disorder where with metastasis, definitely the temperature will increase substantially. Infections of the cardiovascular system, unidentified infections of the urogenital system. In all these infections, fever occurs. Then immune-mediated diseases such as polyarthritis. In immune-mediated polyarthritis, we can see that. See, we have to differentiate between immune-mediated poly, immune-mediated arthritis, that is rheumatic arthritis or rheumatoid arthritis, and septic arthritis. Immune-mediated polyarthritis produces fever, but the pain will be on the carpals or the tarsals. Whereas in septic arthritis, the pain will be on major joints like the stifles, elbow joint, the shoulders or the hip joint. Then systemic lupus erythematosus, fever occurs. For infectious peritonitis, fever occurs. Rheumatoid arthritis, definitely it is having fever. In immune-mediated hemolytic anemia, fever occurs. These are all due to immunological reactions. Immune-mediated thrombocytopenia, there will be a slight rise in temperature. Neoplastic conditions where their endogenous pyrogens are released. Lymphoproliferative malignancies like lymphosarcoma, malignant lymphoma, etc. will be high rise in temperature. Earlier, I met with the case of a Doberman, which was having a sustained rise in temperature. Due to the rise in temperature, one quake was giving some antibiotics for 1 week injection. And then I was called to the house. On first examination itself, I could feel that the spleen is enlarged. First, I thought that it is a VBD when the spleen was enlarged. I asked them to present the dog to the hospital. The dog was presented there. I conducted the ultrasound. Then I saw that there was evenly distributed heterogeneous spleen with enlarged appearance. And focus of infiltration was seen in the liver also. It was lymphosarcoma. So that was the cause of fever, lymphosarcoma. Then myeloproliferative malignancies, leukemia. In leukemia, fever is a must. Especially slightly undulating fever or sustained fever is a must. Then some miscellaneous diseases such as when OTC is given immediately a transient rise in temperature, such as penicillin also. In panosteitis, if a 8 months old pup is presented to you with pain on the, both the forelimbs, you can suspect it is panosteitis. Inflammatory bowel disease, hepatic necrosis, pulmonary embolism, these are all not usually diagnosed. Hypervitaminosis A. If such a febrile patient is presented to you, you have to take the history. Here are the checklist: age, sex, breed, of course, vaccination status, whether it is vaccinated against distemper or vaccinated against parvo or against leptospirosis, diet. See, sometimes fever occurs due to pansteatitis. Cats, when exclusively fed with the fish alone, may produce a condition known as pansteatitis, whereas all the subcutaneous fat becomes inflamed and highly painful. The cat will scratch or bite you when you are handling the cat. That is pansteatitis. Small abscess like eruptions arise on the skin, and that will rupture, and this fatty oil will be liberated. That is pancreatitis. Lifestyle. It's a free roaming cat are highly susceptible to feline leukemia and FIV, infectious immunodeficiency virus. What is the duration of illness? A long-standing fever, or a short fever, or undulating fever, or there is recurring or persistent clinical signs are there. Previous illness or any recent surgery. See, if there is an illness or a trauma happened 2 days before, it will show fever today. Trauma is there, localized or shifting lameness. Shifting lameness always. The first number, worst one, classical finding is borreliosis. We see it is, can be due to Borrelia burgdorferi infection, a Lyme disease. Any recent drug administration, if responding to antibiotics, infectious etiology, corticosteroids, the corticosteroids will mask the signs, clinical signs. Then how will you physically examine the febrile animal? I already said, when you are approaching the animal will be having a high temperature while you are taking the temperature with the thermometer. Why? Because due to excitement. Lymphadenopathies may be there. You palpate the lymph nodes. If the fever is due to an infection, sometimes you can see very recently I saw entire forelimb edema. Only one limb was edematous. Severe painful. The shoulder lymph node was almost like a tennis ball. It is severe lymphangitis. Admitted the patient and we gave multiple antibiotic therapy. I could get the cure in 5 days. Then enlargement of the, is there any enlargement of liver, spleen or kidneys? Go for hepatomegaly, hepatic abscesses, splenomegaly in malignancy or VBD, then renal enlargement, cardiac murmurs, whether it is systolic or diastolic. Localized pain is there, such as abscesses, and the fever is due to the abscess. We have to look. Maybe due to that, maybe due to even Leishmania, infantum infection. Then rectal examination of the prostate gland or anal sacs. Prostatitis produces a long-standing fever, sometimes with an ultrasound. Without an ultrasound, we cannot diagnose it sometimes. Otherwise, we have to put the finger inside the rectum. You have to suspect it. Then only we can insert the finger into the rectum. Joint pain in synovial membranes, carpal sheath, in polyinfection, immune-mediated polyarthritis, there will be pain. Generally, the pain is shown on the carpal joints and the tarsal joints. And in septic arthritis or infective arthritis, the pain is generally shown over large proximal joints such as stifles, knees, hip joints and shoulder joints. Examine the eye of the patient, that is very important. In some of the diseases, there will be corneal pathologies or anterior uveal pathologies. Like we have studied the VBD classes. Corneal pathologies and anterior, especially the anterior uveitis and corneal inflammation is very common in any VBD, like ehrlichiosis, babesiosis or Bartonellosis, etc. Anterior chamber lesions for edema, lesions, hemorrhages, anterior uveitis, and most of the feline leukemia virus and infectious peritonitis virus, toxoplasma, systemic mycosis, etc. shows ocular lesions in the cat. Anyway, you should look for ocular lesions like hyphema. Hyphema will be shown when there is infiltrating neoplastic conditions. Anywhere, maybe a lymphosarcoma or maybe leukemia. Anterior uveitis can be seen in most of the neoplastic conditions and also VBDs. Check the blood for the VBD. What is your diagnostic plan then? screened with the tests, routine hematological analysis with the platelet count, because platelet is important. If it is leptospirosis, if it is borreliosis, if it is any VBD, there will be thrombocytopenia. Or if it is an immune mediated thrombocytopenia, there will be thrombocytopenia. Complete biochemistry profile like the renal function test, liver function test, pancreatic function test, whatever it be, the relevant test can be done. Urinalysis can be done with microscopy. If it is having a recurrent UTI, cystitis, acute cystitis, or acute urinary tract infections, acute lower ferine lower urinary tract disease, so go for the culture and sensitivity of the urine. If it is a CAT, and if you have the test for FELV and FIV, then do it. Take, if possible, take thoracic and abdominal radiographs. If there is lameness, if you suspect panosteitis, take the limb radiograph. Sometimes it could be osteosarcoma, pain due to osteosarcoma. Take the limb radiograph. You can see the sunburn appearance. Check the stools for parasitic ova, steatoria, creatoria, amyloria. All these are seen during definitive indigestions. Steatoria means undigested fat. Creatoria means undigested muscle fibers. Amyloria means undigested starch granules. Even. And occult blood could be angiostomes. Additional diagnostic procedures. Blood can be cultured if needed. Generally, we don't do it. Bone marrow aspiration, especially for diagnosis of Leishmania. Because Leishmania infantum are seen, the mastigots are seen in the cytoplasm of the mast cells or macrophages. So macrophages can be abundantly seen in the bone marrow. Then synovial fluid aspiration for septic arthritis, CSF aspiration and analysis for meningitis. If it is suspected meningitis, take out the CSF. It is very easy from the cisterna magna. Take out the CSF and analyze for pus cells, leukocytes. Take the ECG for the cardiovascular infections. Immunological tests, rheumatoid arthritis factors, can the same human RA factor can be used here also to a certain extent. When IgM or IgG or even IgA are sometimes detected, the human RA factor test can be used here. If the RA factor titer is 1:16 or greater than 1:16, it is said to be positive. False positive or negative results can occur. And in some healthy dogs also, it will become positive. But in real RA factor cases, it will become negative. Those things can be there. Anti-nuclear antibodies for diagnosis of systemic lupus erythematosus, above 1 in 20 is positive. Coombs test can be used for detection of malignant lymphoma, autoimmune hemolytic anemia, etc. Antiplatelet factor can be used for detecting immune-mediated thrombocytopenia, and exploratory laparotomy also can be used if things are not yet to be diagnosed through routine clinical examination or special diagnostic examinations. How will you manage a fever? Symptomatic therapy is initiated when no specific diagnosis of patient shows discomfort. That is what I say. Until you see any significant clinical sign or a discomfort to the animal, don't give an antipyretic for the dog. It always becomes dangerous and it is unethical in the dog, especially in the cat. In the cat, don't give. We all know all antipyretics in the cat are very dangerous. It produces blood dyscrasias, hemolytic anemias, Hinds body anemia. Fluid therapy can be undertaken with antibiotic coverage in sepsis. Flunixin meglumin is excellent antibiotic in the dog. but it should not be used in the cat. 0.5. I have lot of Lonix and Meglumin of which company? I forgot. MSD. MSD. I have MSD's Flunixin injection. Flunixin Meglumin can be used at a dose rate of 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg IV or IM. Excellent for the dog. Ketoprofen or carprofen can be used at 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg. But prolonged use of NSAIDs produces always, it is always contraindicated. It may produce gastric ulceration, vomiting and chronic gastritis. Paracetamol, of course, you know, Hinds body hemolytic anemia. What about hyperthermia? Though I have mentioned about so many things in hyperthermia, I have met with a case of hyperthermia about 6 months before. So, you know, it was actually, when it was produced to my clinic, there was no symptoms. Before that, it was presented to one veterinary college with clinical signs like severe convulsions. And they said that there could be some, because there were no much instrumentations to scan the brain. They said there could be some tumor inside the brain. I also said the same, because when it was presented to my clinic, it was normal. No clinical signs. But the client says clearly that it showed severe rise in temperature with severe convulsions, shivering and convulsions. During that time, it was nothing there. I checked everything. I took the blood, drew the blood and gave it for routine examinations, organ function evaluation, and checked the blood in my laboratory. And I took the ECG, the normal body temperature, everything were normal. And I said, oh, since there is no any clinical sign, I cannot do anything. And the client said that clinical sign will come. Okay, will come means either you should keep it here for an observation. That too, nobody is there throughout for the observation during the night time. You can keep it here. Sometimes you can see that the dog is dead in the morning. That is what, this is the clinical. We cannot do anything. If you admit here means there is nobody to look after throughout the whole night.
Hartford Pharma introduces Hartford Z tablets. Vitamin A 2500 IU, Vitamin D 1000 IU, Vitamin E 25 mg, Selenium 30 mcg, Zinc 20 mg and Biotin 50 mg. Powerful skin nutrition with the power of zinc. Vitamin A, E, D, Zinc, Selenium and Biotin tablets, Hartford Z tablets. Indications: maintaining healthy skin and coat, dry or dull coat, improving rough coat, reducing shedding dry skin and dandruff, improving immunity of skin, hair loss, show animals zinc responsive dermatosis. Dosage for puppies and kittens, 0.5 to 1 tablet daily. For dogs less than 10 kg, 1 tablet daily. For dogs greater than 10 kg, 2 tablets daily. Route, oral. Presentation, 1 into 10 tablets. You can book your order online at www.hatred.com. Looking forward to a long-lasting business association. Thank you.
Anyway, if a clinical sign arises, please bring it again. This client, this lady, she rang up to me by 10 o'clock. It is shivering like anything, doctor, shivering like anything. I said, immediately present it. From a distant place, she presented it. It was having 110 degree Fahrenheit. No, it was a pug, it's a male pug. 110 degree Fahrenheit. Nobody will believe. 110 degree Fahrenheit. I immediately put the ice cubes, the ice pack. I gave the cool saline IV. I gave enema, cool saline enema, and everything. And I put on in oxygen because severe convulsions and it's a blue tongue. Put it on under oxygen, fluid therapy, then diazepam intravenously. So the convulsions were controlled. And we could see that even after the convulsions were controlled, by that time, the results from the laboratory came by evening itself. And I saw that it was having multiple, multi-organ failure, like the liver and kidney, elevated BUN, elevated creatinine, elevated ALP, elevated ALT, all these things. I wondered, how can I save this? You know, the client was crying loudly like anything at night by 10:30. And lady client. Now the people around, they rushed into. It is a silent area. The people around, they rushed into. It was a big scene there. Ultimately, after giving, administering, all the people were there inside. And I gave diazepam, convulsions were controlled. And after that, I left the patient. Go with the patient, okay. She was not happy, but she went. In the morning, convulsions started again by 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock, she said. She rang up to me again. I said, by 7:30, bring it again. She brought it again. Again, I put it on all the same things, the anticonvulsants, fluid therapy, oxygen therapy, everything. And I could not save the dog. In spite of all my mechanisms, in spite of all the knowledge I have, the experience I have, I could not. In the morning, it was again 109 degree Fahrenheit. It was severe hyperthermia. I had two doctors during that time. So my doctors asked me, sir, can we give some antipyretics? No, I said, it is only hyperthermia. Antipyretics will not act here. Only thing what we are doing is right. We can only cool the animal, that is all. Either it could be a heat stroke or could be a tumor inside the cranial cavity. Still, if I speak to the lady will start crying. That much affectionate that pug was to her. Morning by around 10 o'clock, it succumbed, died. In spite of all my therapies, that is hyperthermia, that is a heat stroke. Even it happened in a Rottweiler. A dog show was going on here. Rottweiler, a severe heat stroke, he started panting like anything, then it vomited, it prostrated, it fell down. It was rushed to my clinic. It was severe inspiratory dyspnea, it was a severe inspiratory dyspnea with lot of stertor sounds. You know, our respiratory class has forward. Stertor sounds. The stertor sounds were there. We could not save it because it was severe heat stroke. There was multiple organ failure. Immediately, in just half an hour time, both the kidneys were gone. So that much dangerous heat stroke is. In the textbook, it is told that, okay, we can save it, do this, do that, do that, do that. But in my experience, I can say, it is very difficult to save. The main problem is with the multiple organ failure. And it occurs after 48 to 72 hours. Antipyretics and NSAIDs are of no use at all. Cold normal saline, see, somehow, don't put the normal saline inside the fridge, cooling it to 4 degrees centigrade and giving it. It should not be given. Just cool it for 2 minutes or 3 minutes. Take it out. Let it be a cool saline. Then give it fast IV. To keep it inside for 3 or 4 minutes. Take it out. Give as intrarectal, that is an enema. It will cool down. Corticosteroids can be administered all the time. DIC occurs after 48 to 72 hours, produces multiple organ failure like liver, kidneys and brains, will go like anything, frequently found complication. Brain, liver and kidney will go. This is my experience. How will you manage hyperthermia? Of course, you can bring down the temperature by means of cool saline IV. Intrarectal, that is into the rectum, enema, cool saline enema, ice cool saline enema, packing with cold wet clothes. All these things can be done. IV fluid therapy, oxygen therapy, corticosteroid therapy, all these things can be done. Then hypothermia. When it is assuming hypothermia means the extremities will be too cold. The thermoregulatory mechanisms are no longer able to control the maintain the core body temperature. And this is generally not found in healthy dogs, in middle-aged or healthy dogs. It is generally found in small neonatals because it is a main cause of fading puppy disease, fading puppy syndrome. It is written in my textbook. You can go through the textbook. My textbook, I have found out 3-4 causes. Then in geriatric patients, old geriatric patients also, it is very common. Some other causes are congestive heart failure, where there is circulatory failure producing cold extremities and cold skin, etc. Severe hypothyroidism, of course, we always know a hypothyroidic dog is a heat-seeking dog with cold skin, with cold extremities and low pulse, weak pulse, etc. And during anesthetic recovery, we should be very, very cautious because I have one fatality. During anesthetic recovery, I couldn't go through it because I had lot of cases. The patient was recovering from anesthesia. During that time, cooling went on. Too much of cooling and too much of hypothermia went on and the dog died due to hypothermia. So, invariably we have to take the temperature. Every 10 minutes we have to go and attend it. Every 10 minutes go and take the temperature. Just by catching, holding the extremities and the touching the body parts, you can feel the cold. And prolonged cold exposure. There will be shivering, depression, bradycardia, weak pulse, depressed respiration and muscle stiffness. What will you do? Make a warm wrap. Pack it with warm wrap. Just a simple towel itself will do. Warm the IV fluids, slightly warm the IV fluids and then give IV. And warm intraperitoneal injections. Against other than the hyperthermia, don't give cool intraperitoneal injections. Here only you can do it. You warm the intraperitoneal, warm the saline, only saline you should use. Warm the saline well to 37, 38 degrees centigrade and then give it intraperitoneally. It's excellent. It will increase the body temperature. So these are the things, my dear friends. So thank you very much for listening to me. Bharat Mata Ki Jai.